gotta love it, gotta love it. This one's sitting pretty in the palm of my hand.
I love it. How about you?
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about. Well, good evening and welcome to all our season ticket members here for our town hall meeting. Wow, what a great turnout. I appreciate you being here tonight and hearing about our exciting plans. We're excited to share with you an update on our MLS expansion bid tonight, and to show off our preferred stadium design for the very first time. Well, there's been a lot of conversation out there in the public and the media surrounding the stadium, and we're taking this opportunity to bring the conversation to you, our season ticket members. The stadium design we're presenting tonight, we feel, is innovative and beautiful. We feel appropriate for the beautiful game. We want the stadium to reflect the exciting growth of soccer in our country. And we want the stadium design to connect this innovation of a rising Cincinnati to our history as a major league sports town. We believe this design will firmly plant our soccer flag in Cincinnati as a global city and destination for business investment, jobs, and population growth. Other MLS cities are leveraging the popularity of soccer to compete and win in the innovation economy. We want Cincinnati to win as well, particularly ahead of the other 11 cities we're competing against for an MLS franchise. What do you think? Friends, we know that Cincinnati is a major league community, and winning an MLS expansion bid will continue to enhance our region. Bringing MLS to Cincinnati is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, which is why my family and I, along with our partners, are willing to make this legacy investment for this great hometown of ours. Thanks so much for your support, and now let me introduce Jeff Berding, our GM.
Well, good evening. Pretty exciting evening for all of us. What do you think? We've come a little ways since we had MLS Commissioner Don Garber here just a few months ago. It's been pretty tremendous, right? He was here. We were talking about what a great soccer market this was and how, you know, we have ambition to be a member of the MLS. And now here we are up to our eyeballs in MLS expansion and unveiling for all of you tonight our stadium design. We've come a long way, and it's because of all of you. Thank you so much. I want to acknowledge a few folks. We have a great ownership group. Clearly, none of this would be possible from the very get-go without a great ownership group. So Carl Lindner and his family, Scott Farmer and the Farmer family, George and Amy Joseph and the Joseph family, Mike Moselle and the Dutch Capital Group, Jack Wyant, Steve Hightower, just a tremendous ownership group. Thank you, all of our owners. I also want to acknowledge head coach Alan Koch and all of our FC Cincinnati staff that work every day to make this a great club with all of you. Thank you to our staff. And I want to thank the Woodward Theater for rolling out the red carpet again for FC Cincinnati and being such great hosts as you were a few months ago. I want to remind everyone the bar is open. Let's get them a little bit of business. It's warm in here, so I know everyone wants a cold drink, right? Thank you, Woodward Theater. So let me go over just a few things as we begin the presentation. Number one, we're going to ask folks to do no video streaming. Okay? Listen, this is exclusively for all of you. This is for you to see first. And respectfully, we don't want everyone else who's not a season ticket member to see it simultaneously as you. This is exclusively for you, right? So Tommy G, our great communications and media partner, we are filming this. And we will make this available for the public on our website here in a future date. So we will have it available for folks. But for tonight, let's enjoy it, all of us together in this room. I want to begin the presentation with a review leading into our MLS application, how the expansion effort's going, what's going on, how we got to this point, where we're headed. Okay? Then that'll be followed by Michael Schuster of Michael Schuster & Associates, who's going to give a little bit of an update on our site analysis and where we are in the stadium siting process. And then, of course, Dan Meis from Meis Architects is going to present our preferred stadium design, followed by Q&A and a real good discussion, we hope, with all of our season ticket members. All right, so that'll be the outline of the presentation. I want to give a little footnote on what you're going to see. So we worked with Dan and his team. Remember, the MLS expansion was announced on December the 15th. The application bid was due on January 31st. We had 6 weeks to put it all together, okay? And so what we're gonna share with you tonight is largely our preferred stadium design that was initially developed for one of the prospective sites. Since that time, we've been so inspired by that design that we think that design would work on any of the sites, in any of the neighborhoods we go. But as we present it to you this evening, it will have a focus on one of the sites. I just want to make it clear, that is one of the prospective sites, but it is the site that this design was prepared for. We'll have a couple additional images that we've updated since that speak to maybe a look in a couple of the other sites. Okay, so it's not meant to be an exclusive focus there, but we want to present the design to you, the inspiration to you this evening, okay? So with that, let me kick things off with a little bit of background on how this all began. So the premise here begins with, and people have heard me say it a million times, this is a major league sports town, right? Having the Reds and the Bengals, it's part of what puts us on the map. It helps us outkick our coverage, right? Punch above our weight class. There's a lot of fine communities, fine cities in this region. You think of Dayton and you think of Toledo and Lexington and Louisville. But the fact that this is a big league sports town gives us prominence nationally and internationally beyond our relatively smaller size. So we have proved, thanks to all of you and this club that we've built together, that this is a major league soccer market. And so with that, we wanted to try to bring a franchise to Cincinnati. Why? Well, these are two slides I brought with me from the MLS, or from the NFL, sorry, that talks about the growth of soccer in the sports pyramid in the United States. So this is the ESPN sports poll in 2014 asking Americans, what's your favorite sport? Okay, in 2005, soccer wasn't on this chart. And between 2005 and 2015, dramatic growth to the point that pro soccer is above the NBA and college basketball, just behind college football, and then of course the NFL is king. That's why the NFL gives us this slide, right? I did say I brought it with me from the Bengals. But look at the next one, look at the next one. So this is what percentage of sports are Americans watching by sport? But not all Americans. Americans 18 to 49, okay? So respectfully, my father's generation, he's up here, his generation is baseball, right? But he's over the age of 49. Frankly, so am I now. Okay, but you can see 18 to 49. NFL, still number one. College football, number two. Look at soccer. ahead of the NBA, ahead of college basketball, MLB, NASCAR, golf, NHL, tennis. Again, folks, in 2005, soccer wasn't on this slide. So dramatic growth up the sports pyramid. So all of a sudden, if soccer is this tremendously growing sport that's taken off in the United States, and we're a major league sports town, what do you think? We needed to have a pro sports, a pro soccer franchise of our own. So we went about and with all of you created this organic soccer movement, FC Cincinnati. And you could see it from the very beginning. Number one in merchandise. Just completely took off. I joke with people, we told the USL that we could do 600,000 in merchandise, and they said that we were crazy. And thanks to all of you, you proved we were crazy. Because we didn't do 600,000, we did 1.5 million. And now we have a beautiful team store down on 4th Street that befits this wonderful franchise. We put all of our games on TV. You want to be a professional soccer franchise, a professional sports franchise, you got to have your games on TV. Whether you're home and you and some fans can't make it, some fans are just learning about FC Cincinnati, maybe this year when we're away, you got to put the games on TV, right? The Reds are on TV, the Bengals are on TV, FC Cincinnati, we need to be on TV. So we put our games on TV, made an enormous investment to pull it off with Tommy Glerder and our FC Cincinnati staff, our partners at Sinclair. And our ratings, we outdrew last year the NBA playoffs. We outdrew the EPL. And when Carl Lindner and I have been with some of the other MLS owners and the people in the league office, they look at these ratings and their eyebrows go up and they know that this is something special. So we have to be a visible franchise. But again, this is a major league sports town, and so we want to be in the first division, the highest division in the United States. So we look for the opportunity. We said it from the very beginning. We would love to earn an opportunity to go up to the first division in MLS. So currently the MLS 22 franchises, LAFC comes on next year as 23. It looks like Miami will come on board the following year as 24. And look, these franchises are in markets. A lot of them have planted their flag with soccer as leaders in the new innovation economy. These are cities that we compete with for jobs, for college graduates, for international investment, right? So if you look at Portland and Seattle and San Jose and Atlanta and Orlando, right? They're thriving in the innovation economy, and we want the opportunity to make sure Cincinnati's on this map ahead of those 11 other cities that we're competing with. Why is that a big deal for Cincinnati? The MLS is currently being broadcast in 170 countries worldwide. Live soccer, live MLS matches in 170 countries worldwide. What a great way to introduce Cincinnati and to promote Cincinnati globally than to have an MLS franchise here with our games being broadcast all around the world. We saw a taste of that last year, didn't we? When we brought Crystal Palace here and we had 35,000, the largest soccer event in the history of Ohio, and just a tremendous environment. So we know what the international promotion means in terms of promoting Cincinnati. So on December the 15th, the MLS announced their application process. They said you have 6 weeks to pull together your application. They invited specific cities. It was 12 cities. They said that after you submit the application on January 31st, it's the start of an iterative process. So lots of ongoing communication. Ultimately, we're competing against 11 other cities, but really we're competing against the cities in the East because they're going to add teams 25 and 26, likely one in the East and one in the West. We would then expect 27 and 28 to also be one in the East and one in the West. So we've broken it down how we believe you would break down that sort of regional alignment, right? So Charlotte, Detroit, Nashville, Raleigh, Tampa in the East. Each of them have certain strengths and weaknesses. But certainly, that's our competition. The expansion price that was announced, $150 million is the cost of entry into the league. So certainly, a significant legacy investment for this opportunity. They outlined the criteria, the strength of your ownership group, right? Viability of professional soccer in the market, the strength of the market to support the growth of the MLS and soccer-specific stadium plans. Right? There's other ones, the experience, the business community, political leadership, training facilities, the five-year pro forma, which we had developed over 6 weeks, right, Sarah? We were 1 year into running a USL franchise. We had to put together a five-year projection on running an MLS franchise. But we did that. So really, we think all of these things are things that we can pull off. The key focus is the top four. And so certainly, the ownership group led by Carl and his family, Scott Farmer, the MLS looks at our ownership group and says, that's a great ownership group that they would welcome to have as partners. So that part, certainly, we know we do well, right? So then you get into the proven support. This is where all of you have come in building this thing, building our club. So we have the sponsors from some of the top companies in the region, a lot of national and international companies. And then certainly from an attendance standpoint, we've broken every record in the USL. And currently we rank right up there behind, I think it's only 10 teams in the MLS. So when they look at the attendance, they certainly understand that this is a market that supports professional soccer, right? So sort of check that box. Then you get the strength of the market. And this is the one where we struggle a little bit, and there's nothing we can do about it. So when you look at the TV markets, here's Cincinnati, about the 36th Nielsen market in the United States. In red, if you can see it that closely, are the other 11 cities. So you can see the 11 other cities in MLS expansion are all bigger media markets. So certainly that's one where, you know, again, we're a little bit smaller. We try to make the point combined with Dayton because between Westchester and Springboro, there's not a whole lot left. And that makes us the 21st market. Hey, if Cleveland can claim Akron Canton, we can claim Dayton, right? So, and again, on the population, when they talk about the strength of the market, you know, our population's right down there with Salt Lake City. And so, again, we're certainly viable on our size, but that would by no measure be the leading part of our expansion bid. So then it really gets down to the soccer-specific stadium, and that's what we're all here to talk about. So why people have asked, why do you need a soccer-specific stadium? Why do you need a soccer-specific stadium? Nippert's great. Nippert is great. We love our partnership with UC. We'd like to stay there as long as we can. However, the whole thing here is about winning the MLS competition. 16 of the 22 teams in the MLS this year play in a soccer-specific stadium. 16. Next year will be 19 out of 23. Okay? And notwithstanding that, this is still a league that's growing. So, you know, this isn't the NFL or the NBA or some of the leagues that are, you know, just extraordinarily financially successful. As Bill Cunningham said on the radio today, you know, our games, we love it. It's 2 hours. We have a 15-minute halftime, right? Show up at 7. By 9 o'clock, you're on your way with your friends to maybe go have a drink or go have dinner. If you have little kids, you're getting them home to bed. Having said that, the television broadcast is also pretty limited, right? We don't have all kinds of commercial breaks. And so the soccer-specific stadium is a key means to grow the league and grow the sport with the understanding that, you know, again, the television deals are just much more limited to some of these other leagues, right? And obviously we hope that that will change, but right now it hasn't. And so they see it as a soccer-specific stadium is really essential to grow the league in this country and have teams that are financially survivable, viable, right? And so that's why the key part of our bid is to have a soccer-specific stadium. And at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Michael Schuster, who's going to talk a little bit about the sites.
Well, I don't know how to follow Jeff. Jeff's done an amazing job. Oh, wait, I got a pointer. I'm going to need this. Jeff's done a great thing. He's a hard act to follow. I'm going to try to give it a chance to do that, move forward a little bit. First of all, it's amazing to see everybody here. It just, this is the kind of sport, this is the kind of fans, this is what we need in the city of Cincinnati. This is the kind of thing that we're trying to bring to Cincinnati in a very awesome way. And I think as you start to see the design that's going to come up here in a minute, it is not something that's been done before here ever. So that's all I'm going to say right now, and then you can go and take a look. Now I get to talk about some boring things about neighborhoods, which are not boring, actually, which are pretty interesting. So right now, I think you've heard through the press and through the media right now that there are three kind of neighborhood areas we're looking at right now: Oakley, OTR West End, and even over into Newport. Those are different sites. Those are just different. Those are just different neighborhoods of taking a looking at different things. It takes a while to put everything together. We're all studying and taking a look at these very specifically. So one of the neighborhoods that's being looked at right now is Oakley. Oakley's awesome. What Oakley has done in the last 10 years is just, who lives in Oakley? Oh, only six of you, come on. Oakley's done an amazing thing with our city. It's an incredible neighborhood. And we're taking a look at different locations, different neighborhood parts in Oakley. And we're not sure exactly where that might go in Oakley, but that's an area that when we start to take a look at the kind of environment that we want to have, a neighborhood kind of feel. We don't want to be sitting out in the middle of 275 and somewhere else where you got to go park and you go. That's not who we are. Who we are is about being part of it, being ingrained into the neighborhood, creating a great pedestrian, great neighborhood kind of place. And Oakley is one of those areas, and we're looking at that. Another area that we're taking a look at is obviously, now who lives in OTR? Where do the rest of you live? Yeah, well. So obviously one of the other areas which makes a tremendous amount of sense, integrating that into an urban environment, it is uniquely Cincinnati, is uniquely a great neighborhood, and we're taking a look at a lot of different places. But you know some of the things that happen in OTR, we have a lot of great buildings, a lot of different locations, but there's not a big place that's waiting for something to happen necessarily. So it requires a little bit of thinking. We are working with very significant groups looking at planning issues, looking at infrastructure issues, looking at ideas. What does that mean when we have to park? We have to bring in parking. We have to bring in roads. We have to bring in levels of utility, issues associated with that. And we're looking at all of that to create the best location. So OTR West End is part of the neighborhood that we're looking at. Another area we're looking at is Newport. Okay, so how many people live in Newport? That's two. It's two people. Just kidding. It's evenly mixed. Okay, we know. So obviously, when we take a look at the area in Newport, the area that, and Jeff alluded to this, then we start to take a look at the area where the MLS needed to have a location, needed to have a stadium that was designed at a location. This was just the test fit, if you will, for that location. And it was sitting at the Ovation site over here across the river. But one of the things to realize that even though it is across the river, it is ingrained with our city. And if you start to take a look at, we have the Red Stadium, we have the Bengal Stadium here. It's on this side of Kentucky over here. So everything's being looked at. So as we start to look at it, these are the sites that were the neighborhoods that we're looking at right now. As we start continuing the process, things will continue to evolve. And we're going to get feedback, we're going to continue to look at it, and this is going to be an amazing place. You will see. This will be an amazing place. Thank you.
Okay. So I'm going to introduce Dan, and he's going to start the stadium process, but I feel a need to have a commercial here. On the MLS application, we were required to submit our stadium plan, and we were encouraged to submit it on a plan that the team, the franchise, could control. Any of these other urban sites that clearly there's a lot of enthusiasm about are owned by multiple property owners that in 6 weeks, we didn't have the opportunity to control those sites, right? I mean, just think about the process. So we have a very good relationship with Bill Butler and Corporex over in Northern Kentucky, who's literally pretty much single-handedly developed the entire Northern Kentucky riverfront, okay? We had to submit, I want to stress this again, but remember, the whole thing is to win the bid, right? Win the bid. Win the bid. So we submitted an application on a site that we could control because we entered into a development agreement, in effect, a development understanding with Corporex, all right? So I want to stress again, our whole focus has been to try to find a way, and you've seen some public discussion about this, try to find a way to build the stadium in Cincinnati. That has been our focus, right? However, I want to stress, the sites we're looking at are owned by multiple people, and we may or may not be able to pull it off. So it is great to have the opportunity to develop this stadium in Newport. Again, I think Carl has said numerous times that when his family brings companies and jobs, they've brought them to Cincinnati. And so that's our focus, is to develop Cincinnati. Of course, the name FC Cincinnati, right? However, we want to win. We want to win. All right? And so I would just ask you to be inspired, I hope, by the stadium that Dan Meis is about to present, and then be a part of working with us to figure out a way to get it done. Because ultimately, it's just an image, right? And none of us are interested in an image. We're interested in building something special for this city, okay? All right. So this is Dan Meis. This is our lead architect from Meis. His firm has done soccer stadiums all over the world, some pretty cool ones he's about to show you. So when it came time for us to partner with an international architect to work with us, to work with Michael Schuster locally to develop something that was inspiring, Dan is who we hired, and I think you're going to get a sense of why tonight. Take it away.
Thanks. I'm just glad I'm not going to talk about the site hardly at all. I did want to start with one thing that touches a bit on what everyone's talked about already, and that's what a special moment this is to have you guys here and be part of it. I started designing stadiums and arenas about, I don't know, 25, 26 years ago, and one of the reasons I fell in love with it is I realized that it takes a committed owner, it takes a committed city, it takes a lot of stakeholders, but in the end, it's your building. And it's the only building type where I think that's so true, that you can have 20,000, 50,000, 80,000 people, and it's your new home. And as an architect, that's incredibly exciting to be able to work with the hopes and dreams of so many people rather than us just putting an idea and saying, here, it's great, you'll love it. So with that in mind, as Jeff said, you're going to see some pretty early ideas. We're pretty excited about this, but we're in the process, and that's one of the reasons to do this tonight, is to get some feedback and hopefully get you all very involved in the process. So I'm gonna do, and one other apology, I've got a lot of slides here, I'm gonna go through them pretty fast, but I wanted to be able to share with you a little bit how we got there, rather than just a pretty picture. There's a lot of process, a lot of thinking about Cincinnati, and a lot of history of football stadiums. As Jeff touched on, we've done a number of buildings around the world. I've spent a lot of time in Cincinnati as the designer of Paul Brown Stadium, and did a number of MLB and NFL facilities early in my career. We're currently doing two international stadiums, one for AS Roma, one of the two main clubs in Rome, and we're currently working with Everton, which is the kind of real people's club in Liverpool. So it's another chance of really getting involved. I knew I was going to get that. So here's Roma, and a little bit on Everton. Actually, the design of Everton hasn't been exposed yet. So these are some really early ideas. But again, one of the things that we really focus on a lot is engaging with fans and the sort of history of the site. We're also doing some studies for Bournemouth and Leicester City. some expansion ideas and things like that. A couple of the guys that have worked with me for about 20 years that lead my LA office have had a lot of experience with some of the built MLS facilities you see here. And I was the original designer on Columbus Crew, which at the time, you know, was the very first MLS specific facility, not a very big MLS stadium by today's standards at all, but it really did create the opportunity to prove that MLS could support standalone stadiums. Now, about you guys, one of the reasons I was so excited about this opportunity when Jeff first reached out, besides my history in Cincinnati, was that I had already become pretty aware of what you were doing as a fan base. To not be in the MLS and to provide on a pretty regular basis MLS-sized crowds and the kind of passion of fans behind this, that to me gave a pretty indication of your odds of being successful in winning an MLS bid. We also wanted to approach the idea that there's an opportunity to bring the history of international football to this. One of the things that I think was missing in a lot of the MLS facilities that have been built is that they really became these sort of soccer-specific stadiums. That they had all the technical aspects, obviously, but they missed some of the real passion of both European and Brazilian soccer, places where the history of the game really, really grew up. Here a shot of Dortmund. It's these kind of images are really inspirational to us in thinking about a new stadium. You want it to be a home pitch advantage, basically. And what can we do in the design to create that? These are a couple of images of both of Roma and Everton where we're looking at a very large, very steep, right on top of the pitch home end that, as you can imagine, gives you the opportunity to create a lot of noise in the stadium and really affect the game, something that you guys do well at Nippert already. Just a few slides again about sort of the history of the game, starting to think about what that might mean specific to FC Cincinnati. And I'm going to start to get to the good part here real quick. Sorry. One other sort of driving idea around the team was a city of innovation. And I think it's something that's often overlooked about Cincinnati. There's obviously a great passion here for being an innovative city from a technology standpoint. There's a great architectural tradition. The station, the Roebling Bridge, those were very historically innovative structures when they were built. And there's obviously a lot of great modern architecture as well that really sets up for us that this can't be just another MLS stadium or just another building for Cincinnati for that matter. We looked at the idea that it's wherever the stadium goes, that the game isn't limited to that specific spot, that there are ways of activating the city entire. And the notion that whatever neighborhood you're from, that we look for ways to activate urban activations that really connect you to the event in the stadium. I threw these in here because we were looking at, just to get that laser, we were looking at some opportunities that we would start with a 25,000 seat stadium, but have the opportunity to expand to a 30,000 seat stadium. The numbers we're still massaging, but the notion of, a stadium that has a kind of horseshoe shape maybe and gives us an opportunity to maybe do berm seating in the initial stadium and then that might fill in later. These are just some architectural references. Sorry, some of those slides got taken out. And now back to, as Jeff said, we tested this building on a number of sites, but this will just give you a little sense of the scale on the Ovation site. So back to what I was just saying, the idea of beginning with a horseshoe stadium, but not to create any fear that it's open and not enclosed on all ends. The lower bowl goes all the way around, but we were leaving the kind of berm at one end for our ultimate expansion. It's a little easier to see in these drawings. So back to that notion of innovation, one thing that's not been done in this country in any stadium yet, I guess in the new Viking stadium, this material's used as part of the roof, but there's a pretty well-known stadium in Munich for Bayern Munich called the Allianz. And if you've ever seen pictures of it, it's a building that glows in different colors because of the material. It's called ETFE, you can see here. It's a translucent material, a kind of pillow material that through LED lighting, we can make the whole building glow. And the idea is that, again, with these buildings, they're really event-driven, they come alive. We can create imagery on it, we can make it glow orange, we can make it glow blue. It becomes a very integral part of the whole experience. So that's your first look at it on that site. And back to what I was saying, so most in the first build, the stadium fills all the way around on the lower bowl, and then we have this great fan plaza opportunity and the opportunity for berm seating beyond that. That shows you the color change. We've got a few more of those. Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. I don't know if you guys will be able to see the model right now, but we'll have you come up afterwards. Yeah. This is a view from the Fan Plaza looking into the stadium. So you can see how exciting that material is, because it's not just a canopy. It really does become a very active wall, and it's a very light, dynamic material. And then on this one corner, we were showing a large column that's supporting the roof that's all video screen. And there from the bowl, looking back towards the city. So again, I don't want to wade into the site discussion too far, but one of the things that I was excited about this site is that because we have this kind of big front door, you really do connect right to the city with it. You're looking back on the skyline, and it's one of the things that's easy to forget. When you're in the skyline, you don't see it. When you're across from it, it's really a spectacular view. This is an image of just more of the sort of street scene, and again, the idea that it's not a closed stadium, it's really active at the street level. You can circulate up and around it, and it really creates a very active urban street setting. Another shot of the fan. One of the concourses, looking as approaching the bowl from the players' tunnel. And obviously the idea of the concessions and all of it being very activated with the branding of the club and the bringing the event outside of the stadium. This is a view of one of the prospective club areas looking onto the bowl. And a brew pub again at the street. It's very important wherever we end up. One of the things the MLS really loves is the notion that these stadiums aren't bowls and parking lots anymore. They're urban buildings that really activate their neighborhoods. So the idea that this could become something that's open 7 days. And we're doing this both in Everton and with AS Roma, creating kind of fan plazas outside that might have video screens. These become their own little venues. You can have concerts, you can have away games shown on large video screens, things like that. Again, they become great urban activation spots. Another view of an idea like that. And as you can see, these are all still in development. This gets back to that notion that you have this unique opportunity. You're not across the river from your city. You have these great bridges that connect you back and forth. To me, they become, you know, great fan approaches. And that's one of the great things about football, or I'm sorry, soccer. I use international football a lot because when I say soccer in England, I get beat up. But the notion that it's a game that, you know, everybody comes at one time and they leave at one time. It's not like baseball or an NBA game where people can wander in and leave early. It's a game that people really do care about being there for every minute. And so this idea of procession is really important. This is a view of, as Jeff said, using the design somewhere else. We wanted to make sure that it wasn't locked in until we knew what site it was, but this is looking at a more urban site and adjusting the design a little bit, and it still feels like it works pretty well to us. So again, another kind of view from that fan plaza, but on a totally different site. That's it.